Now, under the old rules, in the old days before there were aeroplanes, once somebody went to Australia from Britain, that was it. You never expected to see them again, because it was just, it was accepted by everybody. It was just too difficult. It was too far away. You couldn't do it. So everybody said, goodbye, that's it. Suddenly, with the advent of the aeroplane, there's a new commitment. You can do it. You can afford it. Therefore, you should. So there we are. And the same with the kids, all relatives, but for kids, you know, middle-class greenies, they will still be juggling to get their kids into the best schools, and there are all sorts of carbon implications for that. Very often busing them to the other end of town in order to do it. Not to mention all the ballet classes and violin lessons and all the things that all middle-class people do with their kids. Then, as far as having children is concerned, this is a sort of big sort of taboo area. Nobody's talked about the population problem very much in the past 20 or 30 years, and it's always thought to be a private thing. You don't think, well, us lot shouldn't have children. We should set a good example to try and reduce the population. In fact, if you do talk to greenie people about this, they very often say, well, actually, if we didn't have kids and everybody else did, then it would be even worse. And there wouldn't be any nice middle-class kids to lead the world to the great green utopia in the future. So I'm going to have a lot. That sort of thing happens. And then, okay, people have pets and dogs and guinea pigs and all sorts of things that, you know, you just think that's all part of it. Not having a nice job goes with having a nice house. So you have the nice house, and then the nice job might be in another part of town. So that forces you to do a lot of commuting because you've got these two different things. And that's something that we all accept as being necessary. But when you're at work, it doesn't count towards your tally. So, for example, here I've come all the way to Australia to give talks about green living and low-carbon living. But I said, that's not me. That's not me. No, I'm doing it for Christopher, or I'm doing it for CAT, which is, so it's a sprat to catch a mackerel, you see, because I will be able to have a bigger effect, blah, blah, blah. So it doesn't go down on my personal tally. Sorry, what? And here we have, of course, the right to get divorced. That's we all seem that. Whereas in the old days that was unthinkable, you wouldn't do it. These days you do it. It's on the agenda, and even middle-class greenies do it. And suddenly you've got two households where before there was only one household, and the carbon emissions have all gone up. And then there's all this shuttling backwards and forwards of all the kids and things like that. But you don't sort of say, oh, we mustn't do that because, you know, what about the carbon implications? No, it's a non-negotiable. The civilized discourse is simply that we're not going to do horrible things to save the planet. So if it turns out that you'd have to do some really outrageous, there would have to be some kind of, you'd have to put all the people who emitted too much in prison, you would say, no, we can't do that. We've got to keep it all very, very nice. Or if it involved very difficult international policy that outraged certain people's human rights, we would say, no, that's not going to happen. We insist on trying to solve this problem in a genteel and civilized manner. And that's a non-negotiable, I think, for most. And then finally, we've got the normal sort of traveling things, is that somehow we always find reasons and excuses for going to lovely exotic places like Australia and somehow not quite counting that among our emissions. So it's not just the common folk, as it were, who've got these cultural barriers. It's us too. And so what I'm interested in, really, as far as other people who are working on this problem concerned, finding places where it's going to, where we're going to find some solutions. And I think the borderline here between these two illustrious nations, academia and bohemia, there's a kind of frontier zone in which occasionally you've got these funny mixed populations and interesting things. I think this could be one area where we might start to find some of the solutions for what we're doing. So probably that's enough, Chris. Any questions?
Same. usage.
Yes, but isn't that good?
Sorry?
Isn't it good? I mean, at the moment, we've got the rich over here and the poor down here. Okay, now we've everybody's got a quota. So you've got to live within your quota, but you can buy stuff off other people. But that means the rich are still emitting, but they're paying through the nose. And that's exactly what we want. We want to get all their money off them, right? So that's fine. In a way, we'll see them flying off. You know, we'll say, great, you know, that's costing them, you know, $5,000, that short flight. That's great. It all goes into the kitty for us to do the things. And so gradually they'll get poorer and poorer. Or they will decide to spend their money on low carbon processes. Yeah, or they'll invest in wind farms or whatever it is. You see what I mean? They'll decide that they're going to do different things with their money. If it's sufficiently swinging, I mean, you know, the carbon price has got to be pretty high. At the moment, it's about $30 or $40 a ton or something like that that's being traded. People are talking about $100. It's got to be something like $500 or $1,000 a ton before people really sit up and make, you know, pay attention. And that, most economists would say that's unthinkable. It just, you couldn't run the world economy on that basis. But that's sort of what we've got to get to. If we've got to get it down to the levels, it's got to be there. So we've got to start thinking ahead. And we haven't got very much time, you see, because these windows are closing. So that's what the frustrating thing is that we are being forced into this these explorations just because we haven't got very much time. Well, it is. It just takes a lot. There's a lot of rebuilding of the infrastructure, of course. But I think what you have to do, if you've got something above the line, you've got to have some stuff that's below the line, you know, to balance it out. So we've got to have some net negative processes. We haven't got very many of these. What it seems to me, logically, if you've only got 20 years, you've probably got to face up to the fact that that's impossible. You know, So you either say, okay, we'll throw in the towel now and that's it. We just forget about it and then we just take whatever happens. If you're still serious about doing that, if we could stretch it out to 50, that's almost imaginable that we could do something with that. So if there is some other kind of technical fix that will produce a few of these, that would be good. Well, for example, Richard Branson, the great Richard Branson, has actually put forward a £25 million prize for the first person that can come up with an actual gizmo that can actually do this kind of thing. At the moment, the only processes we have are based on photosynthesis, because plants obviously do that. They withdraw carbon dioxide out of the air and sequester it. That's why I was asking earlier about making buildings out of these things, because that's a possible way to do it. We constantly grow plant materials, and we make them into some solid form that isn't going to go away, and we make buildings out of it, or we do something with it, so it's not going to go back into the atmosphere. Unfortunately, photosynthesis is very inefficient and slow. It takes up a lot of space, and we need that space for all sorts of other things. So that's going to be part of it, but if we could find some other way of doing what some people call air capture of carbon dioxide, which is not based on plants, that would be great. So let's imagine, it's a job for, is it designers? No, it's not really designers. Anyway, let's imagine there is some chemical process capable of doing this, which can be done on a low carbon basis. And, you know, large parts of the Australian desert, for example, are covered with these great plants withdrawing CO2 out of the atmosphere on behalf of everybody else and get paid handsomely for doing it. Because if there's a price for carbon, there's a price for negative carbon. So if someone can find a way of doing this, then you've got the space for it here.